now been erased forever. We also acknowledge the island of Newfoundland as the unceded traditional territory of the Beothi and the Mi'kmaq. And we acknowledge Labrador as the traditional and ancestral homelands of the Inuit of Mattasina, the Inuit of Nunatsiavut, and the Inuit of Unatukavuk. And we recognize all First People who are here before us, those who live with us now and the seven generations to come. As First People have done since time immemorial, we strive to be responsible stewards of the land and to respect the cultures, ceremonies, and traditions of all who call it home. As we open our hearts and our minds to the past, we commit ourselves to working in a spirit of truth and reconciliation to make a better future for all. Our opening hymn is number 563, The Church's Work Foundation. Our service continues on page 185 of the Book of Alternative Services, page 185. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. O God, you have assured you and family of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Savior. Deliver us from the death of sin and raise us to a new life in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for proclamation of the word.
A reading from the book of Samuel. Then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow in your ways. Appoint for us then a king to govern us, like other nations." But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to govern us." Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, "Listen to the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them. Just as they have done to me from the day I brought them up out of Egypt to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so also they are doing to you. Now then, listen to their voice. Only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." So Samuel reported all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king. He said, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for themselves commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and some to plow his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his implements of war and the equipments of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his courtiers. He will take 1/10 of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and his courtiers. He will take your male and female slaves and the best of your cattle and donkeys and put them to his work. He will take 1/10 of your flocks and you shall be his slaves. And in that day you will cry out because of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves, but the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to listen to the voice of Samuel. They said, "No, but we are determined to have a king over us, so that we also may be like other nations, and that our king may govern us and go out before us and fight our battles." Samuel said to the people, "Come, let us go to Gilgal and there renew the kingship." So all the people went to Gilgal, and there they made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. There they sacrificed offerings of well-being before the Lord, and there Saul and all the Israelites rejoiced greatly. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise.
And praise your name because of your love and faithfulness.
For you have glorified your name and your word above all things.
When I call, you answer me. You increase my strength in me.
All the kings of the earth will praise you, O Lord, when they have heard the words of your mouth.
They will sing at the voice of the Lord, that great and glory of the Lord.
Though the Lord be high, he cares for the lowly. He perceives the haughty from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe. You stretch forth your hand against my enemies. Your right hand shall save me.
The Lord will make good his purpose for me. O Lord, your love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hand. God of creation and fulfillment, help us to seek and discover your purpose, that we may become willing instruments of your grace, and that all the world may come to love and praise your name, in the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
We know that the one who has raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God, so we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasted away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the eternal if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for our gradual hymn number 490, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And then Jesus went home, and the crowd came together again, so that they could not even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying that he has gone out of his mind. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said he has Beelzebul, and by the rulers of the demons, he cast out demons. And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If the kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. But his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemies against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they said, he has an unclean spirit. Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers and your sisters are outside, asking for you. And he replied, who are my brother and my mother? And looking at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Remember the award-winning movie that was released in 1982 of Chariots of Fire. The movie is based on the true story of two British athletes. They were competing in the 1924 Summer Olympics in Paris. And the movie opens back in 1919 England. And Harold Hainbrands has just entered Cambridge University. And he becomes the very first person to ever complete the Trinity Great Court Run. And that was running around the court in the time it took for the clock to strike 12. And Abraham achieves an undefeated string of victories following this. And he wins at various national running competitions. But meanwhile in Scotland, there's a young man, Eric Little. And Eric, who was born in China to Scottish missionary parents, and he's now in Scotland. And he too was achieving record times. His sister, who was a very devout Christian, disapproved of Little's running and his plans to compete competitively. But Little sees running as a way of glorifying God. And he wants to do this before he returns to his missionary work in China. So Abraham's and Little, they meet for the first time in London in 1923, in June. And they race against each other in the British Open, where Little beats Abraham's. So as time goes on, Little becomes more and more involved in his running. And once he even actually missed a prayer meeting. And his sister got very upset with him because he missed it because of his running. And she criticizes him and says, you don't care about God anymore. But Little says that he intends to eventually return to the missionary work in China. But he feels divinely inspired when he's running. And that not running would actually dishonor God. He said, I believe that God made me for a purpose. But I also believe he made me fast. And when I run, I feel his pleasure. So the two athletes, after a year of training and racing, they have both been accepted to represent Great Britain in the 1924 Summer Games in Paris, France. But while they're boarding a boat in Paris for the Olympics, Little learns it from the newspapers that the 100-meter race in which he's a favorite to win has been scheduled on a Sunday. Little has a decision to make. Does he stay true to his Christian conviction to honor the Sabbath, the day that God set aside for rest? Or does he run this race, the one that he's a favorite to win? Little refuses to run. Despite the strong pressure from the Prince of Wales and also from the head of the British Olympic Committee, his religious convictions in the face of national athletic pride makes headlines around the world. Having already won a silver medal, one of his teammates, Lindsay, who won in a 400-meter dash, agrees to offer that race to Little so that he could still have an opportunity to run. And Little, he gratefully accepts. That Sunday, Little delivers the sermon in Paris, at the Paris Church of Scotland, and he quotes Isaiah 40. He says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. On Tuesday, just before the race, the American coach remarks to his runners that Little has little chance of doing well now because this 400-meter race is much longer and not the type of race he's used to running. But one of the American runners, Jackson Schultz, hands Little a note in support of his convictions, and Little defeats all of the American favorites and wins the gold medal. We live in a world where we are constantly bombarded by voices that are calling for our attention and our actions. Each day we're called to make a decision that reflects where our loyalty actually lies. Do we make compromises, or do we stay true to our faith? Do we wait for God to intervene, or do we try to control the outcome of situations? Do we acknowledge God as the King of our hearts and of our lives? Or do we strive to live self-directed lives that aim to please someone else's wishes? The common thread that ran through most of our readings today is the question of lordship. Each of the sections of Scripture we've considered this morning illustrate the different ways, whether it's the nation of Israel saying they want to be like other nations, or Jesus being accused by the legalists of his day of not properly following the rules as they interpreted. We keep coming back to that question of who is ultimately Lord of our lives. As we've seen in many of these passages, and as we all know from personal experience, there's often pressure to conform to what's expected of us, to conform to our culture, and to what the world is doing around us. All of us face competition for our attention. Who calls the shots? Who or what makes the rules that we follow in our lives? What voice do we listen to when we make decisions? This is true for us as individuals, and also corporately as communities and as churches. We might find ourselves ridiculed. We might be deserted by friends and family. We might be condemned by those who have authority over us. Resisting pressure from those who have influence can make us feel very uncomfortable. It can be really difficult to say no. But sometimes it leaves us in vulnerable positions, especially if the person who is pressuring us is someone who has power over us, such as a manager at work, a family member, or a close friend. In every choice we make, we are being asked if our decision reflects who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. As his disciples, we are apprentices in his way of living, his way of living in this world. Does our decisions reflect the love of God, which we are called to bring into this world? Are we participating in God's plan to renew and restore the brokenness of creation? Will our actions in whatever situation we find ourselves bring healing and reconciliation? In order to know what to do, we need to know Jesus. We need to read the stories about him in Holy Scripture and discern how does that apply to our lives. We need to be in community with other disciples so we can discuss the matters of our lives, the decisions that we need to make. In loving relationships, we can discern the best actions. And most of all, we need to pray. Tell God what is on our minds. Speak to him about our problems. And then wait for divine guidance. Wait for God to work it out. God is always listening. He's always waiting for our conversations. So ultimately, the Lordship of God, even in the face of all kinds of opposition, is what is most important. So may we always take time to consider that, to consider who we're following, and may we always let God guide our lives. In all this we pray in his holy name. Amen. We stand as we profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By by the power of the Holy Spirit, became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the People is litany number 3 on page 112. Let us offer our prayers to the source of all love and life. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, we pray for all who call themselves Christians, that we may become a royal priesthood, holy nation, to the praise of Christ Jesus, our Savior.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for Samuel, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers, that they may remain faithful to their calling and rightly proclaim the word of truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for Charles, our king, for the leaders of the nations and all in authority, that your people may lead quiet and peaceable lives.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for this town of Bay Roberts and Coley's Point, for those who live here, the poor and the rich, the elderly and the young, men and women, that they will show the goodwill to all.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the victims of our society and those who minister to them, that you will be their help and defense.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those preparing for confirmation and for baptism, for those recently baptized, that they may be strengthened in their faith.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray, we give thanks for all the saints who have found favor in your sight, for the earliest times, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and those whose names are known to you alone. And we pray that we too may be counted as among your faithful witnesses.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for God's healing grace, for the mercy, and for mercy. Robin, Ella, Alan, Alan, Francis, Liz, Fred, Doris, Fred, Devin, Jim, Wayne, Grayson, and Denver. We pray for all who are recovering from surgeries or accidents, struggle with mental health and addictions, suffering from pain and injury, taking treatments or medications, or experiencing declining health due to age or disease. May you feel God's presence with you in your time of need.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please greet one another with a sign of peace. Our offertory hymn is number 393, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of Creation.
Thank you.
merciful God, the Father, in Adam's fall we were born to death. In a new Adam we were reborn to life. In all we offer you this day, may we share a taste of your eternal kingdom. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. The Eucharistic prayer number 1, found on page 193. Let us kneel as we pray. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right that we should praise you, gracious God, for you created all things. You formed us in your own image. Male and female, you created us. When we turned away from you in sin, you did not cease to care for us, but opened a path of salvation for all people. You made a covenant with Israel, and through your servants Abraham and Sarah, gave the promise of a blessing to all nations. Through Moses, you led your people from bondage into freedom. Through the prophets, you renewed your promise of salvation. Therefore, with them and with all saints who have served you in every age, we give thanks and raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He healed the sick and ate and drank with outcasts and sinners. He opened the eyes of the blind and proclaimed the good news of your kingdom to the poor and to those in need. In all things he fulfilled your gracious will. On the night he freely gave himself to death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Gracious God, his perfect sacrifice destroys the power of sin and death. And by raising him to life, you give us life forevermore. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Recalling his death, proclaiming his resurrection, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you, Father, this bread and this cup. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that all who eat and drink at this table may be one body and one holy people, a living sacrifice on Jesus Christ our Lord. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I am the bread of life, says the Lord. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Drink from the chalice, please just cross your hands over your chest when the chalice bearer comes by.